This roughly is going to be what I want to talk about. I'll be very brief in most of these. That personal transformation, central to personal transformation, is actually self-knowledge. And Mandela is an example, as I said earlier. And so before I talk about Mandela and cite one or two things that I intend to use to try and illustrate that, I'll just spend a few minutes to more or less give you the context of what this is about. Some wise person say, in fact, this was someone called Nico, and he's involved in what we call inner growth or inner development. And he says that for anyone to be wise, you need to develop or to increase your level of understanding. And he called level of understanding is a product of level of knowledge plus level of being. Most of what we get engaged with, particularly academics like us and students who go through education, they have a raised level of knowledge at the end of it. They don't necessarily become wise. In order for one to be wise, you need also to raise your level of being. And the level of being speaks to your own self-knowledge and the knowledge of what it means to be human. And knowledge of what it means to be in fulfilling relationships, etc. That will raise your level of being. And a product of those two is going to give you the wisdom, which is your level of understanding of any given situation. I always contend that Mandela is one of the individuals who not only did have a lot of knowledge, he was very knowledgeable human being, but he also spent some time to know about himself, to reflect. He engaged with a whole different kinds of thoughts. He wasn't concentrating on just learning and knowing about being African, for instance. He learned and knew about human beings across the board to come to an understanding what it is to be him and what it means to be Mandela as a member of a human race. It's just an example of James Flatey, who has written a book on coaching, and it just reminds us that in order for us to be competent in anything, you need to be competent in three domains. And the most important domain, according to him — I didn't draw this to scale, by the way, if I did, this should be all the way up there — the I domain, which is self-management. And engaged in self-management is self-knowledge, the most important thing. If you don't get this right, you're not going to get the next one right, which is the region of relationship, the we domain. And if you don't get these two right, the E domain is not going to save you all that much. This is knowledge. You need these two for wisdom. Zigami has written a book which he calls the Leader Within, and he talks about the importance of self-knowledge in this process. And this talks about knowing enough about yourself to lead others. And that reminds us that our own behavior, or any human being's behavior, is just the tip of an iceberg. What we see in people is an end product of the stuff that's going on inside them. We don't see that. We just see their behavior. And if we are going to change someone's behavior sustainably and consistently, they will have to change their inner being in order to do that. Normally we try and change people's behavior by rules or whatever. Don't do this, we'll be punished. It doesn't work all that way with human beings. They have to change in that process the inside of their behavior. That is just the diagram of us as human beings. We have a core unconscious self, followed by a dispositional layer, a values layer, a persona, which leads to our personality. And all human behavior is a product of all these layers. This is happening in us without even us thinking about it. We make our decisions, we make judgments, we are more or less, we like certain people or do not like certain people. All of that depends on what is going on inside us. So self-knowledge and inner development is actually for us to understand these. Because if we can understand these, we can change those things. And if we change those things, we're going to be able to change our behavior to one that is appropriate in a given situation. By the way, the difference between the dispositional layer and values layer is cognition. Disposition is more or less like reflex reaction. All of us have these kinds of behaviors. We've learned to behave in a certain way. When we meet that situation, we just automatically, we don't even have to think about it. We behave that way. We don't have to think. An example of this is, for instance, I get offended when someone calls me a derogatory name as an African. If my disposition is to slap them, I will do that without even having to think. Okay. And imagine that I'm sitting across the table with my boss in the office and he or she says that, if I use my disposition, I'm going to slap the boss. But the chances are that I won't, because then I'm going to think of the context, the situation, the power issues, and decide slapping the boss is not a good idea, I'm going to react in a different way. Now we're using your values layer to respond. The first one I was using, I would use my disposition. Now, to understand the whole of personal transformation, central to it is actually understanding the human mind. This is an instrument that all of us are born with that we never get to actually even try to understand. It's like we have a software for our running our lives and we never bother to find out what that software, how it works, for instance. Now, I spend a lot of time, some time actually engaging with students on the mind, just to highlight issues that they already know, obviously. Everyone knows this because it's human behavior. We need to have some understanding, to reflect on our own mind. This is just one of the sayings that you need to understand your mind because this is important. Now, I use this slide in the, obviously, in management and leadership and potential, which obviously requires for you to understand your mind to truly create the life that you think you deserve. Here's a question someone asked about what is the mind? No matter. What is matter? Never mind. It's that difficult too. I'll just spend 2 minutes. Okay. 2 minutes is just a model of the mind that I tend to use. I'll just quickly. We've got one part of the mind which is called the discursive mind, and discourse suggests talking. This is a talking mind, the one that talks 24 hours a day about ourselves and making up stories about us and the whole world and other people too. Next to it is memory and emotional charges, which is the storage time. And then the ego, which is the mask, marketing department with unlimited budget. The internet. What is important in this model is just to show us that the discursive mind, actually, its main function is to receive information from our senses. We become more present when we're engaging fully with our senses. Unfortunately, the discursive mind has access to memory and emotions. Most of our decisions are based on past experiences and our emotions of the past, and not what is happening in the present moment. So understanding this model, we can train ourselves to actually be more present, use information from the past, but make sure that it's useful in the present. That's as far as, because I don't have much time. We could go on with a lot of examples of the rest of the model there. This is called the monkey because it's fast, by the way. It moves from one to the other, you know. And now, the beginning of all of consciousness as personal transformation is really, I challenge the students, I say, well, the course, 16 sessions, this is what you need to engage in. You need to ponder these questions. The wise have said, for you to understand anything in the world, you have to ponder this. The most important question is that one, followed by these ones. If you do ponder these, you become wise. And this is what personal mastery is. And I'm going to say something about Mandela having attained mastery. He attained mastery because he became a master of the universe. Being a master of the universe means you understand how the universe works. You understand how human beings behave. And to be a companion of your true self, you understand that in every individual there are two people or two selves. One is obviously the animal self, which is is running us in our day-to-day lives. But each one of us has a higher self. You could call one is like the devil and the other is the saint. There's a lower mind and a higher mind. It's understanding those two. And again, you'll find that if you look at the behavior of Nelson Mandela, he had both for this. There were his mistakes, etc. Like everyone else, like you and I, who have a lower mind that runs our lives. But there's also a higher mind of that he used for him to become, to develop the wisdom that he has. I'll skip this. In fact, I spend more time on this to say that everything in the universe is a synchronicity and synthesis of complementary opposites. You need both for you to actually function best. And it's dynamic. If you move too far to this side, this one will push you the other end. And the same the other way around. Courage and loyalty, you need both of those for you to actually function properly. In our own, if you look at our political situation in South Africa, the more extreme you go with one thing, in that will be seeds to pull you in the opposite direction. I always joke to say South Africa at the moment, some people describe South Africa now, is a bit actually run and managed by the elites, their friends and their families. EFF. Elites, friends and families. In the seeds of that, as you go extreme, a bunch of youngsters start pushing in the opposite direction. They start an organization, guess what? They also call it the EFF. But EFF means something different for them. It's all part of the law of the universe. But let me finish with some quotations on Mandela to say, Mandela, for me, I say that he appears to have gone through the same process of personal mastery. He understood while he sat in prison, no one, he doesn't say anything about having followed any spiritual tradition or religion, but there are some evidence of him having engaged with thoughts across disciplines, across spiritual traditions, and this is just what I'm highlighting. One of the things that he mentions here, he engaged with the mind to understand. And then he said this, the apartheid system was able to imprison my body but could not imprison my mind. For to imprison my mind, they needed my permission and I was never going to do it.
Very good.
And this I'm sure you know about in Invictus, the movie, he quotes Henley, where he talks about this. Henley was a person who was dying of very serious disease and was going through difficulties, but he was very courageous. And he says something at the end. It matters not how straight the gate, how charged the punishments, the scroll. I'm the master of my fate. I'm the captain of my soul. That's mastery. It's just the same one. And this and this one, which I like most. As he walked out of prison, I knew if I didn't leave my bitterness and hatred behind, I would still be in prison. The prison of my own. Thank you.
Amen. Discuss later. He is presenting his paper on a corpus-based rhetorical analysis of selected speeches by Nelson Mandela. Dr. Makamani.
Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Yes, the topic has been given to you by the chair. I will read the abstract because I understand it's not included in the abstract is not included in the booklet. So the abstract goes, a corpus-based rhetorical analysis of four speeches by, they are not four, they are actually more than four, selected speeches by Nelson Mandela reveals the terms African, people, ANC, violence, umkhonto, struggle, country, policy, and white, as some of the most frequent lexical items in the former president's discourse. In this article, I argue that these keywords symbolize a Ubuntu grounded emancipatory servant leadership discourse and epistemology, framing Nelson Mandela as a model leader of African people in general and the world at large. In further editions, the paper postulates that these keyword terms in the rhetoric configures Mandela as a fearless visionary philosopher king, strategist, champion of the oppressed, calm, illustrious son of African soil, an extraordinary human being who dismantled the meanness foregrounding the myth behind white superiority. This analysis reveals Mandela as a pro-people leader and custodian of Ubuntu epistemology, whose submission is conceived as I am because we are, and since we are, therefore I am, according to MIT 1989-2141. Some of the Mandela's speeches subjected to analysis in the study include the Rivonia trial speech and the Pretoria Supreme Court. His speech on 11 February 1990 when he addressed the rally in Cape Town on his release from prison. The speech he delivered at the launch of MIMES at Network at the University of Witwatersrand on 16 July 2003. And his poverty speech delivered in London at the Trafalgar Square on 3 February 2005. So the abstract, that's the summary of the PowerPoint is showing the abstract there for you. Presentation layout. We'll start with the introduction then. This paper presents a corpus-based rhetorical analysis of selected speeches by the village boy, Rolihlahla troublemaker, popularly known as Nelson Mandela or simply Madiba. He is the former president of South Africa, born in 1918 in Vezo village in Kuni, Chamberlain, in Scotch. He died on 5 December in 2013, aged 95, according to Madaja. In this paper, I argue that Mandela's speeches betray a rich philosophy of life and history, branding and epistemological model, much needed by the African continent as it navigates through a gamut of challenges posed by the 21st century, as reflected in the Millennium Development Goals. The collective vision of the United Nations Member States 2000 meeting, culminating in the 8 goals meant to be achieved by all countries by 2015, embraced tangible deliverables embedded in and descendable from Nelson Mandela's rhetoric. As put by Mangena and Chitando in 2011, the goals are as follows: to eradicate extreme poverty and hunger, to achieve universal primary education, to promote gender equality and empower women, to reduce child mortality, to improve maternal health, to combat HIV, AIDS, malaria and other diseases, to ensure environmental sustainability, and to develop a global partnership for development. Findings in the studies reveal that Mandela's rhetoric encompasses three main branches of rhetoric, namely ethnic rhetoric, which is rhetoric aimed at blaming and praising, deliberative rhetoric, which is rhetoric that is associated with speaking in order to influence people to take action, and forensic or judicial rhetoric, which was associated with the accusation category of defense, apologia, according to Kangira and Salazar. The paper argues that it is through this through his meticulous exploration.